ground of being, furnishes inbuilt meaning. As immutable, ever-present Buddha in Buddha fields, we are instantly and innately empowered as Buddha. The universe is spontaneously liberated and perfect in the now. So do not strive to make alteration. Everything is already perfect. Everything unfolding as supreme, all-accomplishing spontaneity. Okay. It's kind of like watering a plant, your handheld watering, you're just watering. And, you know, just the water sort of splashing here and there. And you're wondering, I hope it's getting down to the roots. Well, it all soaks down to the roots and all manages to sink down through the dirt in different ways, right? Get down into the soil and it keeps going down somehow. Water manages to reach the roots. But as we're watering, I'm always wondering, you know, is it really getting there? We're not seeing it getting there. We're just seeing the water on the surface. We're not seeing if it's getting there or not. But certainly, this is just hammering home. I don't know what the sum of it, you know, complete in sum, complete in one. I don't know what the sum of it will be, but it is hammering home for sure. It is hammering home. And we appear to be somewhat stupid, but we can't capsulize it, right? We can't come up with a snappy answer for a teacher, you know? Like, okay, here's a test now. You know, write me an essay. What encapsulate this? No, don't try to encapsulate it. Don't try to come up with an academic position on this. Do not try to come up with an academic position on this. This is phase four. Okay, this is not academia anymore. This is phase four. It's not academia anymore. We're just like a plant, and we're watering the plant. We're just watering the plant of what we are. That's all. Because we're wilted. We're very wilted. And the world is prescribing, hey, you're wilted. You need to eat these. You need to eat these. That will shock you awake, it says. It will shock you. No, it won't. It'll make you throw up whatever remaining hydration you have. It'll devastate you. So, phase four, do not take an academic position. Full stop in the now. Just full stop it. No academic position whatsoever. We would say to academia, I don't know, and that's it. Don't say anything. I don't know. In the self-sprung awareness in the now, where everything is singular spaciousness, our mode of experience is essentially non-dual. A continuity of dualistic perception may arise as creative display, but as luminous mind, appearances and their imputation are non-dual. In the luminous, pure presence that cannot be altered or sublimated, as samsara or nirvana, the universal illusion appears. Let me say that again. In the luminous pure presence that cannot be altered or sublimated as samsara or nirvana, the universal illusion appears. And that is to be neither abandoned nor dominated. For the adept in whom dualistic perception is dead, what is absent but apparent is a cosmic absurdity. In its very absence, appearance shines in multifarious variety. In its very absence, emptiness is all-pervading. In the absence of perceptual duality, we still perceive multiplicity. In the absence of underlying substance, we still transmigrate. In the absence of value judgment, we still distinguish pleasure and pain. Yet looking around, people's mistakes are astounding. Addicted to unreality as truth, they believe in a concrete reality. Addicted to delusion as gratification, they believe in delusion. Holding what is indeterminate as certain, they feign conviction. Holding what is not as what is, they are foolishly credulous. Holding what is valid as worthless, what is worthless seems validated. With the mind preoccupied by different petty concerns, a moment of inconsequential fixation becomes a habit, and a day, a month, a year, a lifetime goes by unheeded. We deceive ourselves by construing the non-dual as duality. When the adept with his pure mind looks inward, the nameless pure presence therein, ungrounded, beggars description, and view and meditation are irrelevant. Wide open, loose and spacious, in spaced out smoothness, there can be no sense of spiritual praxis. No distinction between sessions and breaks in meditation. Everything unbounded and equalized, everything unbounded and equalized without disruption. Without body, object, and perception as a point of reference, because of the smoothness of the vast expanse of the sky, nothing experienced within can be construed as a self. Then looking outside at external appearances, everything seems evanescent, flimsy, transparent, and disassociated. No point of reference remains. Appearance, sound, and thought, every feeling is fresh and crisp. And thinking, am I mad? Am I dreaming? We burst out laughing. Without notions of friend and foe, love and hate, close and distant, no preferences for night or day, the sameness is the totality. And samsara, defined by attributes and reference points, has vanished. Without a thought of the field of self-sprung awareness, we have escaped the cage of belief in moral and perceptual duality. With that realization of non-dual, pristine awareness, we have arrived at the self-sprung vision of the all-good, the place of no return, the point of consummation, until we realize experientially that the field of self-sprung sameness, until we realize experientially that field of self-sprung sameness, we may verbally obsess with the phrase non-duality and speculate confidently about what is non-referential. But such egregious thinking is rude and stupid. So, in the self-sprung modality, without sublimation or alteration, the sovereign consummate aspiration is fulfilled as non-duality, the three realms totally liberated as non-dual samsara and nirvana. The Dharmakaya citadel naturally arises within our inner nature, and it is immaculate, like the sky, we say, although it is actually incommensurable. So long as we fixate on this and that as separate things, caught in duality, we are trapped in a cage of delusive self and other. When, on the contrary, we make no distinction between this and that, When all distinctions are smoothed out, points of reference gone, then Vajrasattva affirms that non-duality is realized. A little bit of antsiness is sure to arise. Of course, of course. Continuity fear says, hey, wait a minute. I gotta get back to what the unreal mind, the belief system, really, of defensive strategies we have, try to avoid imaginary chaos. I say, I gotta get back to that. What is this viewpoint on this? You know, there is no viewpoint on this. It's non-referential, it's non-locational, it's undifferentiated, it's indeterminate. There is no viewpoint on it. See, there is no viewpoint on reality. All right, let us look at this. There is no viewpoint of reality. This is why I'm saying that everyone, the context of the spiritual path has to be repentance. Repentance is basically realizing there can never be a viewpoint of reality. And we have to give that up. We have to give the viewpoint up. You can't even say, I have the greatest viewpoint of reality. That's delusion. Okay, that's delusion. To say, I have the ultimate viewpoint. Now we know that there are those that in this realm of adventitious circumstantial arising, precipitating, like moisture into clouds, there will be some clouds that the label will say, this is the greatest viewpoint. I have the greatest viewpoint on reality. This is what Longchenpa is talking about here, of how to get past that, how to get free of that. Those are fools sunk in a deep, dark pit. And this realm, this world, is saturated with that notion of, you know, of, we have had that, hey, I have the greatest viewpoint on reality, a viewpoint of reality. There is no viewpoint of reality, okay? This is the entire purpose of this. And so we have to have this mood of repentance. And we have to realize that we must let go of this blues package, this terrible blues package, which comes from the believing that our goal is to have the highest viewpoint of reality. This is where our suffering comes from. Is the belief we need to cultivate a gradualist approach so we can reach the highest viewpoint of reality, or maybe just beneath the highest, because the highest will say you can't come up here, I'm the highest. Right, that we think we need to work our way up there. No, this is what Longchenpa is pointing out. This is delusional. This is totally delusional. There is no viewpoint of reality whatsoever. None. Therefore, to be a true teacher, we simply are the bliss. We simply are the bliss. We cannot have a blues package with us. We cannot identify with viewpoints of reality. So we're only talking always in the context of repentance, meaning we accept there are no viewpoints to reality, and we're not trying to reach a viewpoint. But we have this continuity problem, so we slowly back away from the viewpoint, gradualist viewpoint position. We kind of reverse our momentum. Okay, we reverse our momentum. And so we understand it's ragged, but it's right. We're going in the right direction, but backing out kind of, you know. I've got the brake on. I say, whoa, I don't want to back away too fast from this. You know, we keep thinking that we need to reach this high viewpoint, high vision of reality, high viewpoint. There isn't any viewpoint at all. It's beyond, you know, viewpoint entirely, intrinsically so. Okay. This one will be a little longer here. So, here we go, if we're ready. Within the single matrix that is the vast expanse of our nature, sky-like luminous mind is the sky bolt. And I think there's an annotation on that. I'm just going to look up. Mainstay, kingpin, skybolt means the mainstay, a lock of spaciousness, a lock of spaciousness, a spaciousness with a lock that is made of spaciousness, the mainstay. So, within the single matrix that is the vast expanse of our nature, sky-like luminous mind is the sky bolt, is the lock of spaciousness, and its quintessence, its real juice, the superlative spacious, all good Buddha heart, by its very nature, shatters our confining shell. In this singular super matrix, realization and non-realization, liberation and non-liberation are indivisible sublime sameness. The Garuda bird, its wings fully developed within the egg, the moment it hatches, glides into the azure sky, outshining the Nagas. And we will take a look at what does Nagas mean, outshining the Nagas. Serpent spirits of Mother Earth. Serpent spirits of Mother Earth. Probably meaning the imaginary forces of nature. So the Garuda bird, its wings fully developed within the egg, the moment it hatches, glides into the azure sky, outshining the forces of nature, imaginary forces of nature, flying high above the great abyss. So the blessed adept, realizing the Vajra heart on the apex approach, outshines the lesser vehicles and crosses the void of samsara. Let me see if there's... No, okay. We'll do that later. There's some notes here that might clarify. To live in the supreme sameness, that is total liberation, inimical to those on the path of goal-oriented endeavor, validates the immutable sameness of the supreme approach. Everything is blissful in this sky-like Dharmakaya matrix. In this Dharmakaya matrix, nothing remains unliberated. Reality divulges itself as the sublime forms of the Vajra heart, while the karmically generated body is the heart's perfect creativity. When the conditioned body is abandoned in the bardo of life, when the body of flesh is abandoned in the realm of life, everything is pure presence alone, in no way divisible. With the mastery of the victors on the level of spontaneity, emanation emerges without any restriction, and every situation is embraced without impediment. To ride the winds effortlessly defines the adept's career. And although, of course, it is inimical in the lower approaches, Ati accepts it as the crux of fruition. Birth occurs as unborn magical emanation, while the fickle intellect fixates on causal relations. Ati reveals unconditional non-causality. Unconditional non-causality. And what is inadmissible in the lower approaches here becomes the crux. Buddha and sentient beings, the vision and the actuality, inseparable. It is the deluded intellect that holds samsara and nirvana apart. Ati reveals non-duality. And what is discordant in the lower approaches here becomes the crux. And what is discordant in the lower approaches here becomes the crown. Released, to believe and release their realization denies their equality. Ati reveals unitary sameness. And what is unacceptable in the lower approaches here becomes the crux. Only an idiot relies upon a specific method of attainment for ineffable, non-specific realization. Ati reveals ultimacy to be indivisible. And what is inimical to the lower approaches here becomes the crux. All pervasive in the now, Dzogchen is measureless. But it is only the idiot who calls it nebulous. Ati shows unbounded immediacy. And what is disagreeable in the lower approaches here becomes the crux. In the one soul sphere, the linear causal process is reversed. And sky-like sameness unravels goal-related hope and fear. It is fast. It is magnificent. Sky-like Buddha mind. Without goal fixation, the matrix of the one soul sphere. Liberation in the now, whether or not we are realized. Happy the yogin on the sky-like path of non-action. This objectless pure presence of Buddha in the now supersedes the delusory ground and the roaming in samsara. No one can be deluded because no place of delusion exists. Here everything is intrinsic spaciousness in a single matrix of clarity. Free of linear time, it is sky-like open spaciousness. The spontaneity of alpha pure samsara disposed in the now. There can be no attaining liberation or entering nirvana, for samsara and nirvana are unknown in the immutable supermatrix. And moral preference, hope, and fear are unimaginable. In the primordially luminous ground, in that vast matrix, all things are mere label, in reality, unutterable. So neither liberation nor delusion can exist. And samsara and nirvana are already resolved. Make no effort, do not try to change things. Pure presence has no breadth or depth, no high or low, and this boundless indeterminacy precludes any point of reference. Pure presence has no agenda, nothing to do and nowhere to go. And the absence of linear time, an antidote, precludes goal fixation. Any contrived point of reference results in captivity. So setting no goals whatsoever, relax into the totality. Whether or not our experience is released in the now, whether or not our way of being is pure in its nature, whether or not the nature of mind is discursively elaborated, whether or not we bathe in the genuine, authentic disposition, it is all the same. Whether or not we see samsara and nirvana as a duality, whether or not all thought and expression is transcended, whether or not delusive logical thinking has been eradicated, whether or not the existential view has been actualized, it is immaterial. Whether or not we live in contemplation of reality, whether or not we live without discrimination, whether or not we live natural perfection as fruition, whether or not we have traversed the levels and paths, it is all beside the point. Whether or not we are free of all obscuration, whether or not creative and fulfillment stages have completed our reality, whether or not release has been attained as fruition, Whether or not we wander in samsara's six mythical realms, it makes no difference. Whether or not the nature of our being is spontaneity, whether or not dualistic assertion and negation bind us, whether or not we have arrived at the ultimate vision of reality, whether or not we follow in the footsteps of our master, it does not matter. No matter what occurs, even if the sky and the earth change places, we are wide open, hanging loosely, authentic in groundlessness, without reference, disassociated, evanescent, randomized, without either hope or fear. We are uninhibited, divinely mad, view and meditation identical, the intellect's fixations collapse, and we are free of wishful thinking and goal-oriented and goal orientation, and nothing to strive for or to practice remains. So whatever happens, let it happen. Whatever manifests, let it shine. Whatever arises, let it dawn. And whatever occurs, just let it be. And moreover, whatever is anything, let it be nothing at all. Our behavior become unpredictably varied. We are thrust immediately into pure presence, where computation of truth and untruth has no ground. Without reference, in boundless transparency, beyond the trap of philosophy, eating, moving, sleeping, sitting, day and night, a smooth continuum, we live in the sameness of the reality of our own nature, with no gods to worship, no spirits to exercise, no culture of meditation, in an unpretentious, free, and easy state. Here is an unaffected Lord without pride in his sense of totality. And wide open, hanging loosely in spontaneity and oneness, without need to act, secure in the now, stress-free, he is happy. The view is without ground, and meditation is not a state. So there is no discipline to pursue and no goal to attain. No preference anywhere. All distinctions smoothed away. Without need of stress or strain, in zero dimension, we are content. In the absence of ambition, all disciplined practice ends. And with nothing to lose, we let go of remedial strictures, since neither something nor everything nor nothing exists. Whatever appears, whatever occurs, is already released. Since no release by nature in the now or by itself is possible, the unreferenced totality has gone beyond resolution. So vast the matrix, so vast a super matrix, the spaciousness of space. In this all-embracing super matrix, an all-saturating matrix of clarity, bliss and matrix swept into one unitary non-dual matrix, all things whatsoever are self-released, and reality is consummate. Unchangeable spontaneity is what I desire for us all. Moreover, all of us, all those who follow my example, merging the all-embracing now with the super matrix, we have mastery on the level of the all-good. Okay. okay, no academic position, and now I'm just... We're not trying to develop some cliff notes on this. We're not taking notes. We're not taking any notes. It's very important. Fourth phase here. We're not taking any notes at all. We're having faith in the transmission. The transmission is made present in the fourth phase. We don't need to worry about notes. Because the teacher is not asking any questions. This one takes a little while, but we will get through it here. No notes, no academic position, just relaxed hearing, just relaxed hearing. Luminous mind with its alpha pure nature, the invariable reality that has nothing to expunge or espouse, a sky-like matrix, a reality that cannot be sought and found, shines as stellar light simply as we rest in its nature. The sensory fields do not crystallize here. Mind is not reified and unmoving from essential spontaneity. We arrive at the guru vision of the all good vast expanse. Crystal clear space, free of alternation and pulsation, like a still unsullied translucent ocean. In the simple, clear reality of self-sprung awareness in the now, we rest free of fluctuating hope and fear. In a pre-verbal space where there are no habitual compulsions, naturally disposed, unfeigned, uncontrived, and unalloyed, yes, absorbed by the matrix into the reality that has no attribute, neither meditation nor anything to meditate upon can be. Bipolarity, set free, becomes the self-sprung reality vision. All basic thought patterns are the creativity of pure presence. So renounced they may be, but they cannot be eliminated. In their reality, no differentiation or exclusion, no distinction can exist. So, may be present, but they cannot be definitively established. And their true reality is simply known. It's known simply as their spaciousness. And their true reality is known simply as their spaciousness. Without rejecting samsara, we see it as self-sprung awareness in the now. Envisioned through pure authenticity as the creativity of the supermatrix. In the now, sensory appearances and mind fall together as reality, where still contemplation occurs in an uninterrupted flow. This is the Vajra peak, the supreme all-good Buddha mind, the most sublime spacious event, as high as the sky, without differentiation or exclusion. The supreme meditation invests the now, the marvelous Lord that is spontaneity. In the now, empowering clear light is a continuum, a spontaneity wherein nothing is expunged or espoused. This is the supreme vision of samsara and nirvana as spaciousness, the sky-like supermatrix itself, unmoving and ineffable. In the now is the natural disposition of all beings. Seeing appearances as other than oneself is mental delusion. belief in meditation and endeavor is mental delusion. The true reality of delusion is a field of sameness, a state of rest. But in that matrix that is unmoving and alpha pure, there can be no action or endeavor, no resting nor non-resting. Looking at the reality that is unchanging spontaneity, with its intrinsic presence that is free of intellectual interference, looking again and again, we see nothing. Non-seeing is the empowering view of pure presence. In the undiscriminating pure presence that cannot be cultivated, pursuing meditation, we see nothing exists to meditate upon. Non-meditation is the empowering meditation of pure presence. In the non-dual way of being that is free of discrimination, in disciplined conduct, we see nothing exists to practice. Non-discipline is the empowering conduct of pure presence. Secure in the now, in the spontaneity, free of hope and fear. In repetitive accomplishment, we see no accomplishment. Non-accomplishment is the empowering accomplishment of pure presence. In sameness, objects are not conceptualized, nor is mind reified, so fluctuating hope and fear subside. Living in the space where object and mind are identical, reality never moves out of the matrix. Nothing is objectified in the field of attributes. And so thereby we are empowered. In the now, through its non-dual empowering awareness, the great perfection, inseparable samsara and nirvana, without any giving or taking, is an all-pervasive smoothness. Matter and spirit are the same in intrinsic spaciousness, and Buddha and sentient beings are the same in intrinsic spaciousness, and absolute and relative are the same in intrinsic spaciousness, and sin and virtue are the same in intrinsic spaciousness, and the 10 directions are all the same in intrinsic spaciousness. Consequently, everything arising as self-sprung display, at its inception, all the same, nothing ever better or worse. What is the use of positive and negative antidotes? In their abiding, all things are the same, nothing ever better or worse. So let whatever arises in the mind subside into itself right now. In their release, all things are the same, nothing ever better or worse. So in the aftermath, why make any judgment? Everything arising as luminous mind in the ground of being, arising as creativity or display, it is all indeterminate. Arising equally undetermined in the original matrix of the now, though it may seem to arise unambiguously, everything arises as the sameness of intrinsic spaciousness. Again, everything existing the same at rest in reality, though dissimilarity may appear to exist, everything abides in the sameness of intrinsic spaciousness. And again, released, self-sprung in the matrix of primal awareness, even though it may not appear to be released, it is actually released in the total sameness of spaciousness. In self-sprung presence, everything the same in the now, arising or non-arising, everything is always absent in intrinsic spaciousness. Abiding or non-abiding, everything is always absent in intrinsic spaciousness. Released or unreleased, everything is always absent in intrinsic spaciousness. In the pure presence of immutable sameness, at inception, spontaneously arising, everything is known in its intrinsic state. As it abides, spontaneously abiding, everything is known in its intrinsic state. As it abides, spontaneously abiding, everything is known in its intrinsic state. In pure presence, unchanging and unelaborated, everything arising arises in the now. Everything abiding abides in the now. Everything dissolving is released in the now. And its nature is like the sky. Coincident arising, abiding, and release is an uninterrupted flow. No break in the arising and dissolving is possible. In an unbroken stream, cause and effect are inseparable. And because causality is inoperable, the abyss of samsara is crossed. And if the abyss is traversed, downfall is avoided. The matrix of Samantabhadra is the unvarying now. The matrix of Vajrasattva is incapable of alteration or sublimation. Simple recognition of the nature of being is labeled, quote-unquote, Buddha. Again, simple recognition of the nature of being is labeled, quote-unquote, Buddha. With that realization, nothing to adopt or abandon. Everything is smooth into its unique reality. On the Isle of Gold, all things must be gold. Where there are no parameters, no limitations, deviation is impossible, and veils are transparent. So in luminous mind, no downfall possible. The three dimensions are spontaneously, effortlessly complete. And the phrase unimaginable and inexpressible, a mere figure of speech. Sensory appearances undone, pure presence, self-sprung, shines out. And unveiled, without inside or outside, appearances are transparent. In genuine natural disposition, everything shines in supreme reality. Relaxing our body, mind, and satisfaction, hanging loose like someone who has nothing to lose, neither tense nor slack, the body, mind rests comfortably. No matter how we feel, we abide in the nature of mind. No matter how we live, we stay in the nature of mind. No matter how we move in the nature of mind. In luminous spaciousness, coming and going are impossible. No movement in the victor's dimension. Whatever we say reverberates as mind's nature. Whatever is expressed is articulated as mind's nature. In luminous mind, no verbal expression manifests. For the speech of the victors is ineffable. Whatever ideas emerge are thought as the nature of mind. Whatever concepts emerge are conceived as the nature of mind. In luminous mind, ideas and concepts never truly exist. For the mind of the victors is a thoughtless mind. Absence occurring as anything at all is the Nirmanakaya. Enjoyment in the nature of mind is the Sambhogakaya. The absence of any substantial ground therein is the Dharmakaya. The three dimensions as fruition comprise the spontaneity matrix. In the spacious supermatrix of luminous mind, no discursive thought arises. If the ordinary mind is untrammeled by signs of perception, that is the vision of holistic Buddha. Luminosity, in essence, like the spacious vault of the sky, without thought or concept, is the supreme meditation. Luminosity, in essence, like the spacious vault of the sky, without thought or concept, is the supreme meditation. Nothing but our own nature, unmoving and uncontrived, without mentation, nothing at all generated in the mind. That is reality, naturally disposed, nothing changing in time, the supreme meditation where the movement of thought ceases. Whatever rests in that intrinsic nature is sacred, fearless mind. It is holistic Buddha, free of all attributes. It is unmoving spaciousness that equalizes all reifying concepts. It is the victor's vision matrix, the supreme expanse of our being. Abandoning the chains of fabricated body-mind in unfeigned relaxation, regardless of any stirring thought forms, we abide in the ground of being and stay in that reality. Everything is the vast, all-good vision matrix. Free of the stress of compulsive give and take, we are uninhibited, naturally disposed in our very being. The matrix, without parameters, is a still, all-pervasive smoothness, and all thought forms subsiding by themselves into themselves. That is the Vajrasattva's sky-like vision. If we are undistracted from the authentic matrix of luminous mind, though we engage with the mental field that is also reality, but if that reality is adulterated by any compulsiveness, although the matrix is thought-free and spacious like the sky, we are caught in a cage of reified concepts. We may meditate continuously in that way, but it is mere trance. And trance, said Sakyamuni, Sakyamuni Buddha, and trance is similar to the meditation of the gods, small g, of the gods. So it is crucial that mind is undistracted and without motivation, remaining in its natural disposition, transcending goal orientation. Since self-sprung awareness in the now is zero-dimensional, no thing or goal or ideal is ever indicated therein. For all mental elaboration has naturally collapsed. Intellectual stratagems and rational agendas have been abandoned, and we familiarize ourselves with a sublime, groundless expanse. The one holistic reality is self-sprung awareness in the now. The one holistic view is free of discursive opinions. The one holistic meditation neither lacks nor wants nothing. The one holistic conduct comprises non-dual giving and taking. The one holistic fruition detests moral preference. This is the self-sprung guru vision of spontaneity. The universe, material and spiritual, samsara and nirvana, all experience whatsoever is reality from the first. Since it cannot stray from self-sprung awareness itself, all experience is disposed as the ground of being. That is guru vision. Regarding reality appearing as a multifarious field, without worrying about preconceptual disposition, simply rest in naturally disposed and non-pulsating mind and stay naturally in the reality that is the matrix of sameness. Regarding the forms of sensory appearance in a field of duality, by neither focusing the senses nor letting the gaze wander, free of a sense of self or an idea of other, we allow natural clarity to shine in vast, smoothed out sameness. Regarding the forms of In the vision of all identical self-sprung awareness in the now, where free of pulsation, mind is expanded and heightened, experiencing integral space free of outside, inside, and in between. Blissful clear contemplation, free of discursive elaboration, arises. Regarding the vision of reality, unmoving in the quiescent ground, no outside, no inside exists, no elaboration of perceptual duality. And since there is no mind that fixates objects as other, nothing exists to get hold of and no attachment to perception, And nowhere in samsara to take rebirth. There is only the sky. When the mind is not conceived as oneself within, there is nothing to grasp and nothing to become attached. And all habitual assumptions about conditioned existence subside. And the person to be reborn in samsara vanishes. At this point, where outer and inner are both like the sky, delusive experience cannot be conceived or imagined. And we have arrived at the Dharmakaya vision, touching final resolution, coming and going now barred. We reach the supreme citadel of the Dharmakaya, the pure fields of the all good, the all saturating matrix. If pure presence of the now does not stray from the ground of being, familiarization with it precludes strengthened conditional existence. And the karma and habit that perpetuates rebirth run dry. Causality resolved, we say that samsara and nirvana are identical, and being in neither conditioned existence nor peaceful cessation, we have arrived at the luminous heart core that is definitely not a state of one-pointed calm abiding. We have arrived at the luminous heart core. It is the vision of natural great perfection. When we vacillate, losing the essential grounded space, the intellectual mind at work becomes samsara itself, involving causal concatenation that precludes resolution. And inevitably, we fall lower and lower. The supreme secret, the great perfection, on the other hand, never strays from intrinsic spaciousness. And the forms of its creativity naturally dissolve into their source. This vision is the vision of immutable sameness. In this vision, goal-directed endeavor is impossible. So the view, for example, cannot be cultivated, yet out of the space where center and circumference are unified, creativity projects its display into another dimension, where it appears as the multifarious variety of the universe. Never say categorically that cause and effect do not exist. The complexity that arises from interdependence is incalculable. The states of samsaric delusion and nirvanic joy are incalculable. A mass of causes and conditions constitute a sublime synchronicity. When we identify our authentic nature, nothing can be said about it. Likewise, taking authenticity as the path, wholly committed, knowing it only in moments of unimagined, non-conceptual vision, consumed by it, we are completely transparently naked. In this supermatrix, afflictive emotion, karma, and habit create apparitional games of magical illusion. To be free of that, please, we resolve causality. Our method is supreme. Never, never stray from the vision of reality, and cherish the excluded middle. That is the crux of my heartfelt advice. Okay, take a brief break here. Bump up this. Process this academically. Do not process this to pass some test. Do not process it in the form of notes or reminders. It is simply unprocessed. We leave it unprocessed in its raw, organic condition. condition. Just leave it in its raw organic condition. Do not process it. Do not spiritually process it. This is organic. This is natural. This is free range. This is uncaged. Free range. Cage free. Free range. Natural. No processing. No stimulation. Organic spiritual truth. And we simply let it be as it is. We simply let it be as it is. And at the same time, we don't just pick at it a little bit. We vigorously eat the meal. We vigorously eat the meal. There's no time to just like move stuff around on your plate and pick at it and say, what is this? What is this? Huh, should I eat this? I don't know. No, we must vigorously eat it. But it is truly, believe it truly, in its organic state. Within the unitary luminous mind, everything is the same as the sky. Dualistic perception deludes us with causal, conditioned existence. Appreciating those baseless, illusory appearances as magical illusion, through direct perception, calculation preempted, no trace remains. When anger, dismay, envy, trouble, or irritation, anxiety, depression, or mental pain, fear of death and rebirth, and so on, accompanies negative reaction to unwelcome events, recognize it at its inception as a display of creative power. Do not reject it or indulge it. Do not try to purify it or alter it, but rather, without applying view or meditation, in the naturally disposed, smoothed-out totality, free of pulsating thought and image, rest without self-consciousness. The self-dissolving, traceless sky matrix of expansive mind then dawns as intense, clear radiance from within. With unconstrained presence that is neither is nor is not, here we look directly at defocused sensory appearance. Here, because we rest naturally in ungraspable space, here subliminal value judgment vanishes without trace. And here, unfixated experience wells up from within. This simply is the guru vision matrix in the vastness of the now. In the same way, when we are desirous and joyously fulfilled by easy success, friends, good news, pleasure and wealth, and by places and vistas, such pleasure enriches the mind with joy. Recognize this and naturally disposed, freely resting, uncontrived spontaneity occurs in pristine spaciousness. When a neutral state of unaffected indifference possesses us, no matter what arises, neither pleasant nor unpleasant, recognize it at its inception, without repression or indulgence, and it falls into its own naturally disposed reality, where neither differentiation nor exclusion impinges, and dullness is released into the sublime clear light. At night, or whenever sleep overtakes us, lying down naturally disposed, free from mental pulsation, gross appearances have subsided, and with them our attachment. When attachment to the subtle and very subtle has also vanished, the mind as pure presence in its aspect of unthinking sameness abides in its own nature, free of the aberrations of hope and fear. At this time, all basic thought constructs are released as intrinsic spaciousness, and it is described as the release of samsara into nirvana. As in sleep, so in the self-sprung pristine supermatrix, creative expressions dissolve into essential basic spaciousness, and all elaboration perceived there as display subsides by itself. In guru vision, such is the involuntary function of self-sprung awareness. In that way, all desirable, undesirable, and neutral mental states, the three poisons, arise in creativity as display, emerging from intrinsic spaciousness as spaciousness, and since that includes everything, nothing, avoiding anticipation and manipulation of it. The recognition of spaciousness itself and resting therein is crucial, for thereby it naturally subsides, vanishing, released just as it is. Afflictive emotion, karma, and habitual propensities arise as illusory magical display from creativity, and even methods of improvement on the path of liberation arise as illusory magical display from creativity. Everything arises in the now as display of creativity, and it is crucial to recognize it without modifying it in any way. All the same in posture, same in gait, the same in relation to the ground, transcending circumstance, complexity, and causality. And causality superseded, resting freely, we cherish our natural disposition. This, then, is the peak of the supreme secret approach. Do not speak of it of those to lesser acumen. Keep it highly secret. Interpretation will distort the heart teaching. An exaggerated appreciation is at odds with the vision. Violators of secrecy fall eternally into the lower realms. So the legacy of the sovereign secret approach, this teaching, is entrusted only to the fortunate, fearless few. In short, no matter what situation arises, do not engage in it to improve it or to try to suppress it. For the key is pure presence, naturally disposed, freely resting. Pure presence may occur as pleasure or pain, but if we discriminate between them, we are caught in conditioned existence. Everything that appears in the sensory field is identical, just clarity in the face of the sense organ. Everything that arises in the mind is identical, just the same traceless thought. The juncture of object and mind is identical, just the same binding reaction pattern. In truth, ultimately, every perception is identical, just groundless, baseless appearance. Sensory objects all have an identical tendency, just traceless in their unraveling. Mental states have an identical face, just space when identified. Object and mind are non-dual, just pure open space. Whoever knows this is the heir of the all good. The Supreme Bodhisattva, the highest Vidyadhara. Therefore, all experience, equally absent, is identical. Equally apparent and equally empty, equally true and equally false, and we may dispense with all antidotes, all striving, all fixations, and space out in objectless sameness. Space out in mindless, marvelous presence. Space out in infallible, superlative sameness. We are taking the antidote. We are being immunized to this bag of this blues package, this package of the blues that will cause us so much pain in the future, so much suffering, so much that which is cannot be digested, assimilated, which causes us this intense sense of division, of separation. We are being inoculated from that. We are being inoculated from that. So this is the inoculation that we require. And certainly every day we need to continue to inoculate ourselves from what the virulence of what is coming, the virulence, the blues package, the full blues package is arriving on our doorstep, and we are being inoculated from that for sure. So let us keep going briskly. All experience is released here and now in luminous mind. An unreleased event is impossible. Samsara is released in the now, liberated as alpha purity. Nirvana is released in the now, liberated as spontaneous perfection. Appearances are released in the now, liberated in their baselessness. Life is released in the now, liberated in its luminous heart. Mental elaboration is released in the now, liberated in its limitlessness. Formless is released in the now, liberated as pure potential. Pleasure is released in the now, liberated in its equalized reality. Suffering is released in the now, liberated in the ubiquitous basic expanse. Dispassion is released in the now, liberated in the sky-like Dharmakaya. Purity is released in the now, liberated in its empty authenticity. Impurity is released in the now, liberated in supreme, spacious freedom. The levels and paths are released in the now, liberated in the absence of creative and fulfillment stages. View and meditation are released in the now, liberated in non-discrimination. Conduct is released in the now, liberated in the all good. The goal is released in the now, liberated in the absence of hope and fear. Samayas are released in the now, liberated in the supreme reality. Recitation is released in the now, liberated in nonverbal expression. Contemplation is released in the now, liberated in the absence of a field of thought. Affirmation and negation are released in the now, liberated in the middle way. Dogmatic belief is released in the now, liberated in absence of any ground. Authenticity is released in the now, liberated in the absence of any preconception. Inauthenticity is released in the now, liberated in non-critical bias. Karma is released in the now, liberated in its boundless transparency. Afflictive emotion is released in the now, liberated in thorough disinterest. Karmic proclivity is released in the now, liberated in its groundlessness. Karmic result is released in the now, liberated in the discontinuity of experience. Anecdotal method is already released, liberated in self-sufficiency, liberated in the vast sky-like expanse of non-dual give and take. Catharsis is released in the now, liberated in non-repression. Repression is released in the now, liberated in sky-like freedom. Hanging loosely is released in the now, liberated by the absence of anything to relax. Resting freely is released in the now, liberated by the absence of anything brought to rest. In short, all conscious sensory perception and all that is unconscious or transcendent. Let me start again. This. In short, all conscious sensory perception and all that is unconscious or transcendent. Everything is already released in the spaciousness of the now, so any attempt to liberate anything anew is superfluous. It is pointless to try and make efforts towards release, so don't try, don't struggle and strive and practice. Don't seek intellectual truth. Don't meditate, don't contrive meditation. Don't analyze in or after an event. Don't practice the upshot of hope and fear. Don't reject emotional karma. Don't believe in righteous religion. Don't trap yourself. Don't cage your mind. In the absence of an objective field, everything equalized. No discernible point of reference, no object, and no order can exist. The ground collapses, the path collapses, and the goal collapses, and thoughts of good or bad, deviation and error, are inconceivable. Committed to equalization, bound in the now, the universe resolved, samsara and nirvana having reverted to ubiquitous spaciousness, the questions, what is it, and how is it, lie unanswered. What can I do? Who am I? Likewise, unanswerable. What can we do when all our certainties have vanished? We can only laugh outright at the absurdity of it. The entire galaxy of delusory constructs, inner and outer, collapses, and linear time melts into the now, self-dissolving, fading into space. Days and dates fade away. Months, years, and eons dissolve. The one and the many vanished. Sacred and profane both clarified. The one, the delusive ground of samsara and nirvana clarified in its innate spaciousness. Even spaciousness as an intellectually contrived entity dissolves. Whatever we have practiced, however we strive, it is useless. Whatever we have practiced, however we strive, is useless now. An intellectual gall exhausted. What a great marvel is the sky. This pathless vagrant is one with the sky. Since this floating jeweline sky fortress lacking foundation, released in the now, arises spontaneously as guru vision. The threefold universe is released as objectless sublimity. People consensually bound in delusory space-time, ignorant of their own intrinsic nature, are corrupted and stupefy themselves. Such delusion. Their delusion lies in seeing the absence of delusion as an abyss. Deluded or not, the same luminous mind matrix pertains. And there in the now, neither delusion nor release occurs. Reification of what arises from luminous mind as display entraps us. Both confinement and release are non-dual, the mind and its field non-existent. Do not be seduced into believing that what is merely labeled truly exists. Pure presence is liberated by Buddha in the now. So do not confine it in the trap of goal fixation. In the now, in the pure matrix of no objectivity, in the luminous matrix that is blissful sky-like root and base, as alpha purity, samsara is not possible. Within the one soul sphere without edges or corners, the deluded mind holds ideas of unity and differentiation. Within the self-sprung awareness in the now, without causes or conditions, what holds to the samsaric process is a luminous obstructing spirit. Within unlimited non-spatial spontaneity, attachment to a determinate view is the devil of conceit. Within this non-crystallizing emptiness, free of substance and attribute, perverse intellect infers presence or absence, appearance or emptiness. Abandon the cage of determinacy and bias and know the non-spatial spontaneity that is like the sky. Whatever arises in the six sensory fields, all sound and appearance, all is intrinsic clarity in the undifferentiating all-inclusive matrix. Let us come to resolution in the now, in that matrix of space of sameness. Awareness as spaciousness gives rise to all appearance in the unitary sameness. Awareness as the ground of being generates all potential. Awareness as the matrix liberates everything without any application. Awareness as luminous mind is the essential universal source. Know all things as pristine purity, like the sky. Self-sprung awareness is the vast basic matrix of luminous mind. Undefiled, untouched by samsara, it is luminous. Uncaused, all potentiation as spontaneity, it is luminous. And as pure, clear light, the heart of intrinsic presence, it is mind. In luminous mind, everything, all included, is completely pure. With realization of the original face of what arises out of creativity as display, a sudden reawakening to Buddha may occur. Let me say that again. With realization of the original face of what arises out of creativity as display, a sudden reawakening to Buddha may occur. In the absence of realization, oblivious conditioned consciousness arises. In eight fields of dualistic In the absence of realization, oblivious conditioned consciousness arises in eight fields of dualistic perception developed from a genetic basis. And yet, however, the resultant display of the universe appears. And yet, however the resultant display of the universe appears, it can never stray from the matrix of luminous mind. And unmoving from the luminous mind matrix, staying in sameness, samsara and nirvana are united and released in the vast guru vision matrix. In the natural disposition, samsara and nirvana are impossible. Goal fixation is impossible in the natural disposition. The five emotional syndromes are impossible in the natural disposition. Fragmentation and partiality are impossible in the natural disposition. Self-expression is impossible in the natural disposition. In the natural disposition, nothing ever crystallizes. With self-sprung awareness in the now, consummate in nameless reality, no matter what arises, rootlessly as creativity and display, it falls naturally without confinement or release as natural perfection. Release or liberation is cipher for naturally dissolving without residue. And since everything exists and nothing exists are not contradictory, it is expressed by the words released in the now. No differentiation or exclusivity, just released in the matrix of spontaneity. No union or separation, just released in the matrix of the one soul sphere. No matter what manifests, it is released in the indeterminable matrix. Manifest as form, shining, released just as it is. Audible as sound, vibrating, released just as it is. Perceptible as smell, released in its own spaciousness. Savored as taste, felt as tactile sensations, released in its own space. And thought, apprehended, groundless, unsupported, rootless, all is released. Liberation in unity, released in the matrix of reality. Non-duality, released in the sameness of object and mind. Self-sprung liberation, released in the matrix of primal awareness. Spontaneous liberation, released in the pure spaciousness of the ground. Multiplicity liberated, released as the one soul matrix. Indeterminacy liberated, released as the heart matrix. The clear light released, liberated in the stellar matrix. Reality released, liberated in the sky matrix. The objective field released, liberated in the oceanic matrix. Unchanging release, liberation in the peak matrix. Released from the first, released in the matrix of potential. Totally released, liberated in the matrix, Buddha in the now. I'm sorry, totality released, liberated in the matrix, Buddha in the now. Total release, release in the now, liberation in the constantly unfolding matrix. So this just, we need to just let it permeate. It's difficult to actually read it slowly. So I'm learning that. In some ways, nevertheless, we continue on. Nevertheless, we continue on. You see, we keep the accelerator down here. If we gain familiarity with the luminous essence, the luminous spontaneity of things, through the key precepts of non-striving and effortlessness, Buddha in the now is Buddha reawakened. And that is the actuality of the peerless Vajra heart, the essence of the ninefold path, the luminous supermatrix. The sun and moon, clear light mandalas in the vault of the sky, obscured by thick clouds, are invisible. Just so, the luminosity within us is veiled. Just as thick clouds floating in the sky may naturally disperse, so the miasma of causality involuntarily dissolves by itself. And the luminous heart arises by itself in the vault of the sky. But different degrees of acumen require different approaches. Our original face shines like the sun in the matrix of intrinsic spaciousness. Its creativity, without bias, projecting everything as light, filling the land and the oceans with warmth, so that moisture arises as a cloud display that seems to veil our essence and our creativity besides. An impure display of essence and creativity veils the original face of reality that is our heart essence, covering it with a universe of incalculable delusive appearances. Out of creative power, a wind blows. And similar to the sun's rays, it disperses the clouds. As we realize our original face, the display is experienced as ornamentation. Delusion released in the now is now liberated as it stands, and deluded perception and attachment, without denunciation, lie at peace, assuaged in their own spaciousness. The great Garuda's wings develop within the egg, but enveloped by the shell, this is not apparent. When it hatches, instantly it soars into the sky. Likewise, although delusive dualistic perception is already resolved, only when the shell of congealed residue cracks open does the intrinsically clear spontaneity of pure presence arise by itself. Manifestation of Buddha in Buddha fields fill the spacious sky. And though recognition of the original and through recognition of the original face, we are liberated in the all good matrix. As a boundless display of compassion filling the 10 directions, miraculous emanation satisfies the needs of beings. For as long as samsara lasts, such altruistic activity flourishes. Let me start again. As a boundless display of compassion filling the 10 directions, miraculous emanation satisfies the needs of beings. For as long as samsara lasts, such altruic activity flourishes. Activity that arises out of the naturally settled essence of being, as display of our creativity's impartial compassion, abundantly benefiting others. Impure display has completely collapsed, yet transforming emanation suffuses impure beings. by means of the teacher's appropriate responsiveness, and by open-minded people's pure aspiration. Let me read that again. This is not quite right. I need to read this again. Impure display has completely collapsed, yet transforming emanation suffuses impure beings by means of the teacher's appropriate responsiveness and by open-minded people's pure aspiration. Presently, although incalculable environments exist, countless beings therein being drawn into luminosity, they cannot stray from the spaciousness of the teacher's Dharmakaya. For self-sprung awareness is unrestricted, zero-dimensional, naturally occurring within spaciousness as the highest envisionment. An unconceivable Sambhogaya array manifests to fearless 10th-level Rigzin and Dakinis. It is as if, through the teacher's spacious compassion and the disciple's devotion and virtue, mind's original face surely shines forth as spontaneity. In this self-sprung awareness in the now, itself the Dharmakaya, the all-inclusive display is a lake of all-knowing impartial awareness, the one soul sphere of pristine spaciousness. The essence of the Sambhogakaya is natural spontaneity, and the five Buddha families and the five modes of primal awareness as display of pure presence fill the entire gamut of the sky. The essence of the Nirmanakaya is the ground of manifest compassion. Let me say this again. The essence of the Nirmanakaya is the ground of manifest compassion, the display appearing wherever and as whatever action is needed, demonstrating thereby perfectly appropriate activity. These modes of being defy goal-directed endeavor. They shine only in freely resting space as the spontaneity of the now. This supreme secret is disclosing itself at this moment. And since we shall not be lured away from it, even in the bardo, this apex approach of the Vajra heart towers exalted above all progressive, graduated approaches. Conclusion. This song of the Vajra heart of reality, its alpha pure nature like the sky, occurs as self-arisen display, neither transforming nor sublimating in unchanging groundless space. It evokes the vast supermatrix, the all-pervasive sameness of the now, so that without going anywhere, in the natural state of alpha purity, in unrestricted and zero-dimensional freedom, we may enter the reality of immutable spontaneity. The center of the vast sky-like expanse is our concern, the sovereign self-spring supermatrix, where unmoving everything is released as it stands, where we reach the vast womb of ineffable spaciousness. Such a sky-like adept, his realization certain, composed this short poem from his own experience. In accordance with the formal transmission and the scriptures, the 21 texts of the Mind series, the 3 sections of the Matrix series, and the 4 sections of the Secret Precept series. Through the merit of this work, may all beings, excluding none, without effort, realize the space of alpha purity, and as princes of reality, spontaneously provide mutual benefit in the unalterable, non-sublimating realm of Samantabhadra. Let comfort and ease and prosperity spread everywhere. And as in a pure land, may wishes be spontaneously fulfilled. As the drum of reality beats, the banner of freedom unfurled, fearless awareness is sustained. and Dzogchen revelation increases. An adept of the apex approach, Longchen Rabjampa composed this treasury of the Dharma Dhatu in the throat of the White Skull Snow Mountain, and it is now completed. Hallelujah. Thank you for the immunization, the inoculation, the immunization. We're receiving the inoculation daily here. It's kind of like a rabies series, right? We are being inoculated from the rabidness of the present delusional situation in the world. The unspeakable situation, really, in this world. The rabidness of the world. We are being inoculated from the rabidity of the world. We're being inoculated from the rabidity of the world. Now, this inoculation cycle from rabidity, it takes a series, right? You get a series. For rabies, you get a series. And I'm telling you, the rabidity of this world requires this inoculation. I like this in conclusion. The center of the vast sky-like expanse is our concern, the sovereign cell-sprung supermatrix, where, unmoving, everything is released as it stands. Where unmoving, everything is released as it stands. Where we reach the vast womb of ineffable spaciousness. Where unmoving, everything is released as it stands. Right there is the key. Where unmoving, everything is released as it stands. This is inoculation from the rabidity of the world situation, where we will not define it here. We are simply being inoculated from it by the, yes, we will not define it. We are simply taking this series of inoculation. Very great. That's not so bad. I mean, it's like a chemotherapy inoculation. It's like, wow. Now I gotta go. I need to eat something. I'm feeling like, and it's not easy, right? I got low blood sugar. I got tired. I got feeble. Struggling a little, but just continuing on, keeping the accelerator down. Okay, get a little shaky. It's not totally easy, is it? It's not totally easy. There's not a sense of total ease. That's okay. This inoculation is taking root. We are being inoculated from the perverse rabidity of insisting that we hold on to the blues package, and that we must assimilate this. We must work on a progressive assimilation of this blues package, okay, of this King Naga chocolate. Speaking of the Nagas, the so-called imaginary forces of nature that are supposedly causing a progressive, graduated approach into some inner self. The Nagas of nature, this is the King Naga itself right here. This is the King Naga itself. This is the chocolate Naga that they're serving. And this is the King Naga, the red King Naga, and the chocolate Naga. We're being told that we need to assimilate all that. And the seven pot, Maruga scorpion seven pot, whatever. We're being told we must assimilate all this. We must progressively assimilate it. No, as Longchenpa says, an adept says, standing just as it is, Where unmoving, everything is released as it stands. Where unmoving, everything is released just as it stands. We are being inoculated and freed from the misery, the unassimilatable misery of attempting to assimilate what is always already pure spaciousness. From a dualistic standpoint, the assimilator and what is to be assimilated. So we will not elaborate upon that. We will stay unelaborated with this. We will stay unelaborated with this inoculation. We will stay unelaborated, and we will now break from this video, this inoculation exercise, this inoculation series. Very great. Congratulations. Most certainly, this is very effective inoculation. All thanks to the pure compassion that is the Dharmakaya, pure spaciousness, that is here right now, effortlessly releasing itself as pure compassion, reaching everywhere in its unmovingness as it stands, reaching everywhere. We give all thanks for that, for this inoculation, this necessary inoculation. All praise, all praise, all praise. That's it.